the less likely you are to be here until 10 o'clock every time this happens. So I just wanted to say thank you all for that opportunity. There are some words that we have that are buzzwords in our society that are attached to connotations, right? So two of those that are very popular at the moment are reform and accountability. So those are generally seen as very positive things. What I want all of you to know is there's not a single teacher who has been here tonight or who teaches anyone in our state who is against accountability. There's no teacher who is against reform. We are against the wrong kind of reform, and we are against the wrong kind of accountability. There needs to be correct measures, and we are the ones who are saying we want to help you do that. All right, so I hope that y'all are hearing that tonight. All right, so we can all agree probably that a persisting narrative of education in the state of South Carolina has not been positive. I would argue that teachers have not been the author of that narrative. All right, South Carolina schools are failing. That's what we keep hearing. And this is a false narrative that's pervading our communities, our mindset, and the media. The narrative continues to be pushed by faulty accountability systems, and this bill perpetuates that. You've heard a lot about accountability tonight, so I'm going to skip through a good bit of my comments on that. But I do want to say that the biggest thing that I have an issue with when it comes to standardized testing is that at the end of the day, it does not measure student growth. There's no student growth measure that is attached to accountability. I cannot tell if the kid answered a question right because they actually knew it or because they guessed and they happened to get it right that time. When we can determine that, then we can talk about it being an actual accountability measure. It certainly does not address teacher effectiveness whatsoever. Okay, so that's one of my points. The next thing is talking about the report cards. So the accountability piece is tied to our report cards that we get. Report cards are not new. But the professing that a school is failing on a report card, for some reason the Education Oversight Committee has considered Speaker Lucas's request to put off some changes that we know are needed. These are requests that have been researched and have been addressed. And they said that, you know, we published this report card and we were going to make these changes, and now they're wanting to put that off until 2022. So I want to kind of picture a story for you. What our state could look like in 2022. If this bill passes as it sits, and all right, we know that there are going to be some amendments and some changes. But just assuming that this bill were to pass as it is, right? Underperforming schools get taken over by a charter management company. They become privatized, essentially, in our state. If that happens, and these report card measures haven't been changed, we have schools that are going to be dubbed as underperforming, as failing schools when they're not failing schools. Right now, we're only looking at one measure of the South Carolina profile of a graduate. We're looking at one-third of that, the mastery of content. We're not looking at the other two pieces. The report card changes are going to help prove that. It's not perfect, but would improve that and would allow those report cards to show a real reflection of what's going on in South Carolina. It's not inflating scores on the report cards. So the business community has asked for these changes, and for some reason they're going to be pushed off until 2022 is in the proposal. If that happens, then we're just benefiting the charter management companies who are going to come in and take over the schools. And I have large concerns about that. All right, so addressing the free college tuition for teachers in underperforming schools, I think that was mentioned briefly earlier. This is kind of a problem for me as well. I think it was meant to be positive, but it doesn't solve any problems with schools and teacher pay. It's ultimately going to be what retains teachers into your teacher pay. So saying, hey, your kids can go to school for free in a college or university if you teach in an underperforming school is not going to be beneficial because that just perpetuates the underperforming school because that's where the benefit lies. Right, but then within 2 years, that school would be taken over and sent to a charter management company, so then it's not really any benefit for that teacher. So that's not something that's going to be beneficial for our communities, for our students, for our teachers, especially not the communities and the students who are most vulnerable. Representative Collins mentioned on a post about a 5% adult college teacher pay increase. I call it the teacher pay adjustment. Because that's really needed. And he's saying that that's now mathematically impossible. And I'm not saying that you all agree with him or have seen that. But I'm confused because that was proposed by multiple people, including our governor and the state superintendent of education. So what concerns me is when I get my paycheck, it's really measly, right? And I cry because it's sad. And then I see my bills and I cry a little bit more because that's also sad. And then I have to pay my bills. And whatever is left is what I have to live on. My issue is when the state is looking at their budget, okay, and you guys are looking at your budget. I don't get to decide that the electric company is only worth $40 this month and be like, oh, I have an extra $100 surplus every year. That's not how that works, all right? So I'm confused on how it is that the state is not appropriately funding and we have extra. There were two different, I believe, surpluses this year, all right? We're not paying what is due to South Carolina, and that needs to be changed. It's past due. The bill and the change in the time for teacher pay and funding for education is past due, and it's the time to stupid part thing is right now.
Paige, thank you. Will you tell us again what your, where do you teach?
I teach in Lexington, District 1.
Okay.
This is my ninth year in education.
This is a question I really wanted to ask a lot of people, but since you brought this up, I want to ask. In the best world, tell me what test, over and beyond what we know that the feds pass down to us, what the state and your district mandates that you do. Tell me what tests we can do away with.
So, honestly, none of them are really beneficial. Because by the time something has to be done, then the state wants to know before the federal mandates know. So everyone wants to know ahead of time. And everyone wants to measure kind of what the progress is. So by the time you get one standardized test that's in the door, right, then it's just going to compound all these other tests. Because now we need to track the progress and we need to know that they're on target to meet that goal and all of these different things. The tests that I've had the most experience with as an educator in the classroom myself are the what used to be the SE Pass test, which is now SE Ready. The changing of tests and the standards are also ridiculous because that doesn't provide any continuity in education. But then the EOC, and I believe someone spoke to the end of course exam earlier, is not providing us any information, and it really doesn't. I get a score back that counts 20% of a kid's grade. I guess people thought if they tied it to a student's grade, it would provide them buy-in. That's not a motivator for them to be successful. It truly isn't. And we get zero feedback on what it is that they need to improve on.
So what you're saying is that with the tests that we're giving, other than what's mandated from the feds, it's not helping our teachers at all move our students and grow and to know where they are.
That is what we are saying.
The matter is, you are saying that you, at the as the teacher, know better how the growth is of your student. And at the end of the day, the report card is for who?
That's a great question. I would love to know the answer to. It gets published in this way that it drives the economy in a sense, because people want to live and work and shop in places where the schools are positive. And I don't know if these things are being graded on a bell curve, but we don't grade on a bell curve anymore. That's not a sound practice, if you will. But it's a huge concern for us, because these standardized tests and all the accountability pieces are false accountability pieces. If you want to look at what a kid really knows and what teacher effectiveness really looks like, you need to be in the teacher's classrooms. And I know that you said you visit a lot of teachers. But really being in the teacher's classroom, go to a school, ask for the master schedule, and give yourself your own walk around. Don't let them take you on the dog and pony show tour, because that's what they're going to do every single time. Go talk to real kids, be in real classes, and stay in there for longer than just reading a book to them. I mean, go in and really stay there for a whole lesson and question the kids and ask them what they're learning. That's what's going to make the difference. And really looking at student growth measures. If you can look at a student's growth over time, that's something that no standardized test will ever tell you. And that will account for more days. Saying that you have 180 days with kids and then giving the test 20 days ahead of time and then saying that this one day is what matters, percentage-wise, doesn't add up to anything that deals with the test.
So when the test results do come back, do you as a teacher get to look at them and know what's going on with your students?
When it has the end of course exam, absolutely not.
Those kids have already gone to the next grade.
So the only, do you get, in your district, requires map testing or of that type. Do you get to look at that so you know where your child, each child is and where their weaknesses and strengths? Do you get to look at that?
We get to look at it, but it's not always aligned to what we're told we're supposed to teach.
Okay, exactly.
Because there's these national norm tests, but our standards aren't nationally normed.
Right.
Very good.
And then we have magnet schools within schools to bring up test scores. We don't talk about that very much, but districts create magnet schools within
Right. If you're gonna, if you got testimony, you need to come give it up here. Thank you so much, Paige. Oh, one question from Representative Gals.
Sorry, I know we gotta go. And you hit something. You said what we're told we gotta teach. Is that how you said that? Is that what you said?
Yeah.
Who? What? Explain that to me, because I mean I may feel a little different. I don't know. Can you explain that to me? That's nothing wrong with it. I just don't understand it.
Depending on what district you work in and kind of what the schools say, who your leaders are, all of that is very, all of that's going to play into what it is that you are teaching in your classroom. And it's not, you know, teacher choice. We don't get to walk in our classrooms and teach whatever it is we want. Having standards is a good thing. Having standards that judge course, is a positive thing because it ensures that there's some basic knowledge skills kind of across the board, across the state, that students are expected to know at certain grade levels. Now, I would argue that not all of those standards are developmentally appropriate for kids, and that needs to be looked at. But when it comes down to it, we're supposed to teach things that match those standards. What a lot of districts do is they say, well, we're going to use this particular curriculum. And when you're using this particular curriculum, we're going to read these particular stories, or we're going to look at things in a certain way. And a lot of that can pin down the teacher and what they're able to do in their classroom for their kids.
Yeah. So the flexibility is not there in some cases for you to teach what you've been taught to do.
It's not. And a lot of it is not the district trying to do anything bad, but they're trying to match programs that are going to cause progress, that are going to get them the scores that are on these tests.
Thank you very much, Paige. And we have two more on the list, but did you have something you wanted to add that you might want to come to the podium and add?
I would love to do that as well.
Okay, well, we're